celebrating 15 years of Young Turks.
Hello and welcome to this special edition of Young Turks. We are in conversation with Hari Menon, co-founder and CEO of Big Basket today. Hari, let's begin by talking about GST. So we are just about a couple of weeks away, literally, in terms of the challenges that you might have faced in getting all the compliances in place. Talk us through what's been happening over the last couple of months and some of the challenges that you think you will face post July 1st.
We've now understood what's really required, to get GST compliant. More importantly, we are actually making sure that from a system and a back-end perspective, we are getting aligned and, getting everything that's necessary again to get compliant. The other side of it that we are really working on is working with all our supplier partners to make sure that we have the least amount of disruption as far as our stocking and our stock levels are concerned. And we've been looking forward to it actually, because what it does is we are actually spread across 25 cities. And currently what we do is from a model perspective, we end up having purchase and buying operations in most of these cities locally. Now what we can do is we can do away with a lot of that and centralize our supplies at our key locations in tier one cities. The other thing that a business that we've been working on, and we should roll it out post GST, is the business which we call place of origin. There are a lot of products that are very, very specific and very unique to cities and very unique to certain regions. The opportunity now available is that we can seamlessly take these products and ship them across to similar communities to other parts of the country. So that's the other thing that we will enable, that business will become easier for us to operate post the GST regime.
All right, in terms of the upside that might accrue because of perhaps centralizing the stock keeping in a sense, or the inventory management in a sense, what could those benefits be?
Since we currently buy locally, there is a certain amount of minimum stocking that we need to do of products, because a lot of our suppliers would supply in some minimum lots and minimum order quantities. All that goes away. So what it essentially does is that in most of our tier two cities, the level of stocking will drop dramatically, because we will not be doing any local buying. Everything comes from a centralized location. So we can even ship it, three times, four times a week, which otherwise we would actually buy maybe once a week for some products, because volumes could be low and people wouldn't supply multiple times a week. By supplying more often, what it does is it helps you reduce inventory. And when you hold lesser inventory, it helps overall costs from an inventory holding perspective. And that's a great benefit that we will see accruing to us in at least about 17 to 18 cities of the 25 cities that we have.
Just in the immediate term, there have been certain concerns raised about inventory which is already in-house, liquidation of that presently. How are you dealing with that? As well as going forward in the months immediately after, there is a concern that there might not be that supply as smoothly as one might expect.
So essentially right now, we are actually stocking up. We are actually carrying will be carrying a little higher inventory at least, and building it up towards the end of the month so that we don't have any issues during transition. Most of the companies are working closely with us to make sure that while we transition, any difference that could accrue in terms of tax rates, etc., we get protected on.
All right, so let's move on from GST and let's get the elephant out of the room in that sense. Hari, reports about Amazon acquiring or in talks with Big Basket. In turn, there are rumors that Big Basket is looking and talking to Grofers. So what do you want to say about all of this? Let's get this out of the way.
Yeah, completely untrue. And, I don't want to, discuss anything that's related to speculation. All this is completely untrue.
So you're the oldest player in this space in India. You're also a market leader by a fair margin. You've survived the sort of spat of the smaller players shutting down and so on and so forth. So what do you, to your mind, are the 5-6 things that you're doing absolutely right? And in that sense, those have become your moats.
The first thing that I'd like to talk about is what we really looked at and decided to completely focus on and invest in is essentially making sure that we have a very, very robust backend. The biggest thing that a consumer looks for today in online grocery is convenience, right? And what this means is that convenience is coupled with providing great fill rates to the customer. And when I say fill rates, when you order 100 items, you know, the customer wants all 100 items, because if you don't deliver one, then the customer has to go back to the store. And if the customer has to go back to the store, then they might as well buy everything there. So it puts a lot of pressure on us to make sure that we run very, very high fill rates. We currently run at a 99.5% fill rate, which globally is benchmarked as one of the best from a metric standpoint. Number two is on-time delivery, right? We've got to make sure that we deliver on time. Customer chooses a slot. We currently run at close to 99% on time. And number three is to make sure that we have our in-stock number, which means when a customer comes and looks at our website, which today carries close to about 20,000 SKUs or 20,000 products, the availability of these products for them to order is very, very high. And another global benchmark there is to have close to 98% in stock, which means when a customer comes to your site, 98% of the products are actually available for the customer to buy. And we're currently running upwards of 95 to 96% and constantly working towards moving that up to 98%. And then the last 2 years, we really moved our focus to really the front end, which means, you know, we started pressing the pedal, we marketed ourselves, we expanded to okay. cities, we got our brand ambassador in place and wanted to, you know, really make sure that we get growth and we get our sales numbers in.
Having said that, how do you view competition, right? So a large part of it, I think Grofers is one of the last few Indian competitors standing. Of course, they're in a slightly different category and segment, but, you know, still in the online grocery space. We are now seeing Amazon come in, you know, and kind of aggressively target this market. Will we see, you know, the battle that has gone down in traditional e-commerce between Amazon and Flipkart? Amazon very fast closing the gap with Flipkart, in spite of Flipkart having that you know, massive leeway, play out in groceries as well.
We really need more competitors in this particular segment. And overall, the market size is so large that it's impossible for this entire market to be served by one player. It's not possible. The second thing that I keep talking about as far as this is concerned is that this particular category, the shift of customers from physical buying to online buying is a lot more difficult and a lot more trickier than it is, say, when you buy a mobile phone or when you buy, you know, some electronics. But this is a category where a typical large order has about, on an average, 26 items in it, right? So pretty much, you know, customers will choose one site because they will create their own smart baskets, they will create their own shopping lists, so that shifting is not as easy. You won't buy sugar from one site, rice from another site, potatoes from a third site, because it's just impossible to manage that, right?
Correct.
What will happen is, when more and more players come, there'll be more noise in the marketplace, people will advertise, and it'll overall benefit every player that's there in the online space.
Okay, everyone has enough space to play. So you are presently 5 million subscribers strong, correct? And a large part of these are in the 25 of our biggest cities. So now in that sense, is the game forward for you actually deepening the market in each of these 25 cities? Or is it going to be targeting a larger network of cities? What's going to be the strategy, let's say, in the next year or two?
Our expansion to cities is over. It's complete now. You know, because one of the things that we really need to look at when we expand into cities is also a factor which physical stores don't have to look at, which is internet penetration, right? And we've studied that, and we've figured that, you know, these are the 25 cities that has the best possible penetration that we're looking for from an internet standpoint. Because without that, you know, we don't have a business going, right? Today, even at 5 million, you know, users that we have, and even from a revenue that, you know, that we're doing today, which is close to about 1,400 crores, we still have huge amount of legroom available, of space available to grow.
You're not expanding cities anymore. So getting deeper into each of these markets, is that going to take up actually your customer acquisition cost, right? Because the conventional thinking would be like the, you know, so the low-hanging fruit is already there. The 5 million are already there. What is it going to take actually to target the next 5 million in these 25 cities? Give us a sense of how you plan to approach this. Is it going to be another SRK big campaign, or is it going to be something else this time around? What will work?
Great question. You're absolutely right. Our acquisition costs will keep coming down. Because one of the things that kicks in extremely well for us in this business is what's called word of mouth. And when word of mouth kicks in, obviously your cost for acquisition comes down, and that's a real big play for us. That's one. The second thing that we're really going to very, very aggressively use and push for is this whole gamut built around analytics, right? We know our customers well. We know what they do. We know what they buy. We know their profiles well. So we're going to work on them to make sure that we will provide them what they want, right, with a lot more accuracy.
Correct, and but that's another mode for you, right? Because you have,
absolutely.
7 years of building up this data that, a competitor won't have immediately
absolutely.
At their disposal.
Absolutely. And that's what we're really going to use. And certainly, we will also continue to push hard on the marketing front. We have a great brand ambassador.
I said expensive brand ambassador too.
Not really. So if I, separately will tell you that, what you spend in terms of, using your brand ambassador is far, far higher actually. So, but making the customer buy more and buy more often is what analytics will do. So both have a large role to play, and we will actually use them very effectively.
Also increasing the average ticket size or the basket size, right? I believe it's presently at close to 1500 rupees for the scheduled delivery of products. And then for the more express delivery, it's
yes.
in the range of around 550 to 570. What must this average...
Yeah, it's now closer to 700, yeah.
Okay, now closer to 700. So what must the average basket size increase to as well commensurately for you to, break even in certain markets or in certain categories?
You have to look at both, right? You've got
right.
to look at, the city itself, because each city has its own dynamics, right, in terms of costs that we incur in those cities, right? The category play is the second thing that actually is very important. For example, the more fruits and vegetables we sell, we drive higher margins. I think we're pretty much there on the average order value piece. It went down a bit when we saw a shift happening from the desktop to the mobile. We did a lot of things internally in the way the customer behaves, and we actually pulled that back, and it's now back to normal. So we're actually pretty much there as far as the average order value piece is concerned. We're pretty much there as far as the margin mix is concerned. Each city behaves differently, so we have different metrics which we track
right.
to make sure that the cities are all aligned.
Okay.
And the great news is that our first two cities, which are also two large cities for us today, which is Bangalore and Hyderabad, have broken even
right.
completely at the city level, including marketing
right.
in the full service business. The other good piece is that by December of 2017, the entire full service business, which is about by value, a little over 85% of our business will break even at completely at the city level, right?
Okay.
So I think from a unit economics perspective, we've kind of cracked the issue. It's just that because there are different variables in some cities, it's taking a little longer. The next two that will fall in place is going to be Chennai and Ahmedabad. And by December, we'll have the entire FSD business in tier one cities having broken even, and that's upwards of 85% of our business.
All right. So while this is great news, I'm just going to pull up the numbers from last year. I know that you perhaps have some insight into the unaudited numbers for this year as well. So the losses as of last year were at close to 277 crores on a top line of 563. I think earlier you mentioned that you're looking to do close to 1500 crores this year. Have the losses gone down in perhaps in percentage terms, if you want to give us an idea of what we can expect this year?
The burn as a percentage of top line would be significantly lower than the number last year.
What has contributed to this becoming significantly lower? So what was it that you were doing in the last year that actually took that number up to close to 300 crores? And what did you not do in the last year in that
essentially,
sense?
Essentially the unit economics playing out, and what you get actually in our business is that it is a business that does extremely well at scale, right? So the more you scale, the unit
right.
economics looks better.
Okay.
Because more you scale, your cost of delivery comes down. Because the average distance that a van travels starts coming down when the density in a
okay.
city in terms of orders increases,
okay.
right? And the top line having grown from close to about 600 crores last year to 1400 crores, it has been one single contributor to the
okay.
fact that the percentage has dropped significantly.
celebrating 15 years of Young Turks.